Well, as for most British people, Dunkirk's a story that we grow up with. I can't even remember the first time I was told about the events at Dunkirk in 1940. And as a storyteller, you're always looking for gaps in the culture or the cultural record, and stories that should have been made into modern films that haven't been. And Dunkirk is certainly one of those. I think it's one of the great stories of human history, and it hasn't been addressed in modern films until now.
Talk about how you weave together the timelines from the different perspectives of land, sea, and air. You're weaving together those timelines and yet creating a sense of urgency, a race against time in each one.
I wanted to tell a story with an intense subjectivity. Dunkirk is a survival story. It's the story of 400,000 men trapped on a beach with the enemy closing in on all sides, and a desperate race against time to get these guys back home. I wanted to put the audience on the beach with these guys. I wanted to put the audience in the cockpit of Spitfire, battling the enemy in the air. And I wanted to put them on the decks of a small boat with civilians coming over to try and help these guys. And so to do that, decided to tell the story intensely subjectively, but from three different points of view, so that over the course of the film, as these stories sort of braid together, you get a more coherent picture of the larger events of Dunkirk.
And what it was like to be there. You've been vocal to that end about using real effects as opposed to CGI. Talk a little bit about that on Dunkirk and how that will affect the viewers.
Well, what we try to do is do as much in camera as possible, do as much for real as we can. We want the film to feel tactile and physical and authentic. We want it to play in the present tense in a way, really, that the audience feels that they're there, that there's no screen between, you know, us and the events of 1940. And to do that, I feel very strongly that we shouldn't use too much visual effects. We shouldn't use too much in the way of computer-generated imagery. And so we really try to do as much in camera as possible by sourcing real planes from the era, real boats, and putting the actors into as close to the reality of the situation as we could safely do.
I understand you and Emma, or I've been told, you guys made your own channel crossing some years ago. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me a little bit about that and the impact it had on you?
Well, I made the crossing with Emma and a friend of ours who owned a small boat. We made the crossing to Dunkirk at about the same time of year that the evacuation had taken place. And it was far more difficult than any of us expected. The channel really did not cooperate. The seas were very rough. It took a very long time. It took, 19 hours to get over there. And so the arduous nature of that, and the difficulty of that, and the fear of that, and that's without people dropping bombs on us. That's without there being a war zone at the end of that journey. That experience really cemented for me an admiration for the people who took part in the real evacuation. That's very much a driving force of why I decided I wanted to make this film.
It's amazing. And talk about what it was like to fly in an actual Spitfire. I just talked to Jack, who was saying how amazing it was to be there and have the pilot also running camera behind him, and the camera's right, the other Spitfire's right there. What was it like for you to ride in one in pre-production?
Well, I had the opportunity to ride in a Spitfire in pre-production, and I got my director of photography and my production designer to do the same thing, because we knew the task of the film was to put the audience into that seat.